We are about 7 years into Proton and 3 years into the Steam Deck, and we are still dealing with anti-cheat problems on Linux. Now, most of the major anti-cheat systems have Linux support. Things like BattleEye, EAC, so on and so forth. Now, there are some anti-cheat systems like EA's Javelin, which don't have support at all, and most likely never will, at least considering the way that EA tends to talk about Linux anytime it comes up. But even in cases where the system they are using is supported, a lot of game devs don't go and enable that support themselves. So they could do it, but the game's still broken. And if you want to keep an eye on what games do support it and don't support it, there is Are We Anti-Cheat Yet? This is a really good site. And if you're specifically looking for Steam games, ProtonDB is a great place to go. You'll find whatever game you want to see and any other thing you might need to do to get it working. And this article is a few months old, but basically everything it's saying is still entirely true today. Things really haven't changed. The only thing that has changed is now there are new games that have the exact same problem. If you switch to Linux today, you'll probably be surprised by how many games run out of the box just fine. In my case, I don't even really check anymore. I just buy the game, I install it, and it usually just works. If it doesn't work, I need to change a Proton version, maybe use GE, maybe add a launch option. But again, all of that stuff's going to be in places like ProtonDB or documented somewhere out there. And it's usually like a 15-minute effort to get the game working. And then it just works. And then I never have to worry about it. Except for a lot of the competitive multiplayer games with any sort of anti-cheat technology. There are some exceptions, but most of the major ones, yeah, have this problem. As someone who uses Linux daily, I would love to see these games supported, but I just don't see that happening anytime soon. Just because there is support on Linux, that gives people the false perception of what that support actually is. And the point of this article is to explain how, even though we have these anti-cheat systems, we don't really have them. So first up, we need to explain what a video game cheat actually is. Like, how does this function? How does it allow you to cheat in a video game? We could talk hours about whether all sorts of macros and exploits should be considered cheats. You could also talk about, you know, hardware-based cheating, where a game that doesn't have a crosshair, your monitor can add a crosshair, or games on console that don't allow you to use keyboard and mouse, but there are devices to make use of keyboard and mouse, which gives you an unfair advantage over the regular players, because you'll still get the controller-based aim assist, but you also have the advantage of a mouse. Or you have YouTubers who are electrically shocking themselves as a way to make their finger move faster than they can make it happen. That's a real video. I'll leave a link down below if you want to check it out. But the main thing that comes to people's mind when talking about multiplayer games is an external program that somehow manipulates the game or reads information from the game to provide you with an advantage over others. A prime example being a wall hack or an aimbot or infinite ammo, infinite resources, teleportation, things like that. There are generally two ways you can go about doing this. One is external, having a completely separate process that copies memory between itself and the game, or internal, where you force the game to load a DLL, a shared library file, directly into the game, executing custom code from within the game. Either way, doesn't matter which approach you're going with, you're still going to need a way to read and write the game process's memory. Now, a bit of a little detour, but still very important. Let's imagine this situation. Two programs are loaded in memory. What is stopping one program from directly accessing the memory of the other program? Well, in the past, nothing. Absolutely nothing. This would have been perfectly possible to read almost any of the physical memory installed in the computer. Nowadays, OSs use virtual address spaces, though. Basically, you are allocated chunks of memory, and due to computing magic, these chunks on the actual physical RAM aren't necessarily going to be next to each other. And the main point here is the memory of these different programs are supposed to be isolated from each other, and to access the memory of another program, there are specific APIs that need to be interacted with. This is a big part of the reason why when you're dealing with low-level memory access, things like buffer overflows are incredibly dangerous, because you might access memory that you don't intend to access, you might overwrite memory you don't intend to overwrite, and this can cause all manner of issues. So when we're talking about modern anti-cheat, these have three main goals. One, block other processors from accessing the game's memory whenever possible. Two, detect and ban anyone who tries to get around the blocking mentioned above. And three, once someone is banned, ensure they cannot simply create a new game account and continue playing through hardware ID bans and various other sorts of bans like that. And this is why when we're talking about client-side anti-cheat, like EAC, like BattleEye, like Vanguard, like Javelin, like all of these things which cause so many issues on Linux, this is why they're a kernel mode driver, because without that, there is no way to effectively block memory access into the game. With the kernel mode driver, though, this is incredibly simple. All that driver needs to do is register a callback for handle creation, filter out requests to open such handles to the game process, check the request permissions, and if they allow memory access, either deny the request or lower the permissions. That way, no user mode process can now read or write the game's memory. Same can be applied to module loading and file system access. Now, there are forms of anti-cheat that do not do this, that do everything on the server side by validating the game data. So ensuring that, hey, this user doesn't have more ammo than is possible. Their movement speed isn't higher than some range. They are not higher than the game limit should allow them. Their position isn't inside of some terrain, and various other things you can validate. And this does work quite well. The problem is a lot of games just don't make use of these checks. And the reason they don't is doing so is incredibly difficult. You need to have a very deep understanding of what a player can reasonably do in a game. How fast can they reasonably go? How should they be able to achieve those speeds? How do they get to certain heights? And are there any areas that you can maybe clip into terrain that you shouldn't be able to clip into? How do you define exactly what is clipping into the terrain as opposed to being positioned in a weird way where you're crouching and slightly breaking a terrain barrier? All of these things need to be accounted for when we're doing server-side validation and doing it well. It is far, far easier to chuck on some client-side kernel mode anti-cheat and just make sure the user isn't running any software they shouldn't be running. Now, when we're talking about Windows and kernel mode anti-cheat, there are ways to get around it. Those ways are quite difficult, though. One of those ways is to get their code into the kernel, which will open many ways for them to access the game's memory. Notice how I highlighted somehow. That's because Windows is a closed system where Microsoft has the control to decide who should get access to the kernel. All official kernel components are signed with Microsoft code signing certificates, so it's trivial to verify their authenticity. All third-party drivers need to be signed with an EV code signing certificate, which can only be bought by companies, and then go through the Hardware Developer Center certification so that they can be loaded. And the author isn't saying this is perfect. It is absolutely not perfect, and there are definitely ways to get around this verification. And then, of course, is the exploit route, whether that's exploiting some valid driver that has some sort of bug, or possibly exploiting a bug in the anti-cheat system itself. And this is where the second goal defined above comes in. The anti-cheat has to actively scan the system and try to find code that is not associated with any legitimate module and other modifications or patches that would otherwise not be there. This is part of the reason why some users playing Battlefield 6 had Javelin freak out about Valorant also being installed. It's early version of the game that's obviously going to be ironed out, but Valorant is also something running in the kernel, and I guess in certain configurations it was thinking, hey, that Valorant thing is, that's bad. You shouldn't have that. That's gonna break our game. Most gamers are gonna say that those anti-cheats are useless and they see cheaters left and right. And it is absolutely true that a game with anti-cheat is going to have cheaters. But it's like, here's a good example, right? Let's say that you leave your bike outside. Someone might steal that bike. It'll be really easy to steal. It's just there. The bike is just free. It's free real estate. But if you put a really big lock on the bike, if you take the wheels off, if you do a bunch of other things that make the bike way less valuable, someone might still take it. But less people are going to be interested. And it's the same idea here. If you have an anti-cheat system, people are gonna get around it, people are gonna cheat. But the barrier to entry is considerably higher. And then there is the banning of players. If you just ban someone and say, oh, you're gone, who cares, get out of here. They can just make a new account and then, you know, keep doing the exact same thing. They might get banned immediately again, but they can just make a new account and keep doing the same thing. This is where things like IP bans and hardware ID bans come in, and since the anti-cheat has a kernel component, it can directly talk to the hardware and read its serials that way. If it was only running as a user mode process, it would be trivial to fake the serial reads. Now, obviously, this has a lot of problems, like, for example, secondhand Switch games which have been dumped, leading to people who bought those games getting their consoles banned, because they technically are running a dumped game, and Nintendo doesn't like that, and the same thing can happen with CPUs that have been hardware ID banned as well. If you buy a CPU like that on the secondhand market, well, you might already be banned from a game and have no idea it happened. In the cases where those bans do expire, you're in a good situation, but there are definitely cases where you have hardware ID banned hardware, and you're banned for 100 years, which effectively means you're banned. Now, moving over to the Linux side. As you can probably tell from the extensive rant above, I don't have much good news. Linux is an open system. There is no central authority like on Windows that would tell you what you can and cannot do in the kernel. That obviously has countless advantages and is why so many people and big corporations love it, but it's also the reason why anti-cheats cannot really function like they do on Windows. So, one of the things I think a lot of people don't know about EAC and BattleEye and any of these other client-side anti-cheats that do work on Linux is they are just running as a user mode process. They effectively are not doing anything. All that the game is doing is basically saying, we're okay with the tiny percentage of people that are using Linux. We will deal with them if they cheat, but we can't actually stop them doing anything unless they are just doing the most basic of basic shit. EAC, BattleEye, all of these that run on Linux do not run as a kernel mode process, do not run as a kernel module, so there is no way for them to block or detect memory access into the game. Now, I don't agree that anything you could think of would not work. A kernel module? Fair, would not work. Mandatory kernel patch? Same thing. User mode detections, you can just run the game in a fake root environment and that's totally fine. I disagree that a mandatory custom kernel build would be an entirely bad idea. The author says, well, at that point, you might as well just use Windows. I disagree. I completely disagree on this point, and I think this is the most viable path forward. Basically, like you have from Windows, if you want to play anti-cheat games on Linux, have some sort of verified signed kernel, and you cannot make any modifications to that kernel. Whether that kernel comes from Valve for the Steam Deck or from major distros like Fedora, Ubuntu, so on and so forth, specific signed kernels that you know that this is going to be a safe kernel. This does create issues for NVIDIA, and that kernel would have to have the NVIDIA modules loaded automatically, or we would have to go down the route of the open source NVIDIA drivers, which would break older hardware. Right now, there's still a lot of people on pre-10 series that this could be a problem for, so I can't imagine that happening anytime soon. Also, if you need to load any other kernel modules, you basically wouldn't be able to do so. This, though, I think is the only real viable path forward if we are talking about client-side anti-cheat. There have been attempts to get anti-cheat to work on Linux. EAC is the most prominent one. Developers can choose whether they want to allow it to run on Linux or not. Linux gamers look at this and use it as an argument that anti-cheat on Linux does not face any issues, and in the past, when I didn't understand how this actually worked, I felt the same way. But the truth is that apart from some basic sanity checks, EAC does absolutely nothing on Linux. It's just a simple module that facilitates the server connection and data encryption slash decryption for the game. If you want a great example of this, go to any cheating forum, go to the section on Linux cheats, and see how easy people have it. See how little effort they put into working out how to cheat. So little effort, in fact, that people generally don't even charge for cheats on Linux. In a lot of cases, they're even open source. That's not going to happen on Windows. Windows cheating is big business. Is all hope lost? Well, maybe, but if you want to achieve the best results, you need to utilize both active and passive measures. Active being the kernel component on Windows blocking memory access and trying to find possible discrepancies, and passive being the code virtualization, obfuscation, game data encryption, as well as proper game networking and server-side checks. I don't entirely agree that you need the client-side component. And I think as we start seeing more AI-powered cheating systems that replicate human behavior, but replicate pro-level human behavior, and we start seeing these cheats move out of the game itself and start moving into external devices, I don't know if these client-side checks are even going to work anymore. An example of how not to utilize kernel mode anti-cheat would be Fall Guys. This game is very specific. There would be no gain in having some sort of wall hack. There would be no gain in having some sort of aimbot. I disagree on this point. You might want to aim as you're diving at someone, but it's not aiming like, you know, a first-person shooter. All the people did was speed hacking and modifying the game in a way that allowed them to jump higher and generally change their movement. This game is a prime example of why you should write your network code properly. If the game had proper networking and server checks in place, tick-based system, actions performed on both client and server, if there's a mismatch, the server is the authority and resets the player. That's how CSGO did it, and that's why people were not flying over the map in that game or speed hacking. It had other issues. There's definitely cheaters in CSGO. If you have proper server-side validation, you don't necessarily need anti-cheat. As I was saying earlier, this is really difficult, and a lot of games don't want to put the effort in, and it's far, far easier to just outsource that problem to a company that's already solved it on the client side. So if you're a game developer and want to limit cheating in your game on Linux, write proper networking code, verify data sent by the client so your game server does not blindly accept Mach 8 as a walking speed, use code obfuscation and virtualization as much as possible, try to change it a bit with every update. If you have control over the game engine itself, try to keep sensitive information on the stack as much as possible, and make sure you don't ship debug symbols with your game. There is a lot of games that have done that, and it makes it great for people who are doing decomp efforts and things like that. It also makes it very easy for people who want to cheat in the game to cheat in the game. I do not expect the situation we're in to change anytime soon. I do think the most viable route forward is a company, most likely Valve, right, with the Steam Deck, having a signed kernel that they work with the anti-cheat developers. They get the anti-cheat in kernel mode and all that good stuff. Well, not good stuff, but all the stuff we kind of need for these games to be functioning. And then basically you use that kernel and that's basically all you get. Is this a perfect solution? Absolutely not. Is there a better one? I can't think of one. If you have one, I would definitely like to know. So if you like the video, go like the video. If you play multiplayer games and you want them to work, hey, give it a thumbs up, go subscribe, all that good stuff. And if you really like the video and you want to become one of these amazing people over here, check out the Patreon, subscribe, Steli Barapay, linked in the description down below. That's going to be it for me, and are you a dirty little cheater? Like this.